is going on here? Come on. Oh, there you go. Jesus, Cliff, we're here to watch your show. Why don't you open the door, man?
We got questions.
Lots of questions.
I seek answers.
Bigfoot, I doubt this. Come on.
What's going on here?
Another whole night ruined. So with me are a bunch of Bigfoot aficionados and friends of the Squatch in general, and they're going to shoot questions at me, and we're going to talk about the first episode of Finding Bigfoot Season 2. All right, shoot.
You're fine.
I feel like this Cliff is like Teddy Roosevelt, and this is a fireside chat.
Fireside theater.
So right. We want to know about this show here, Cliff. Come on, what's the real deal? We're not buying it now. I don't think Cliff really saw an old Bigfoot no way, no how. So lay it on us here.
Actually, the New York episode was great. We actually had, in my opinion, Bigfoot encounters on both night investigations. The first night at the baby footage site, we actually did get knocks. Those are the real knocks that are in the show that we actually heard. And the second night investigation, we got 5 howls. You only got to hear 1 on tape, but we got 5 howls. The New York episode was epic. We really did get Bigfoots.
Not 1, not 2, not 3, not 4, but 5 howls.
That's correct. I can. You know what? I taught 6th grade for a long time. I can count that. Right there.
Did the howls have a New York accent to them?
Well, they didn't have an accent, but I could almost see the middle finger sticking up at me.
The gum chewing in between howls. It'd be the howl then.
Yeah. Right.
Snooky squash. One of my favorite questions is, what didn't make it to the show? What ended up on the cutting room floor?
You know, in this case, again, we shoot like 100 plus hours of footage and they whittle it down to 44 minutes. So in this case, a lot didn't make it to the actual episode. A lot ended up on the digital cutting room floor. Probably most noteworthy was the interview with the zoo curator. The zoo curator, like I was giving him questions like, okay, here we have something in a tree. What is this thing? And he says, oh, it's clearly an ape of some sort. So assuming that it was a person with a pet ape, I asked the curator of the zoo, so if you had a pet gibbon, which is the most likely candidate for misrepresentation here, if you had a pet gibbon and you let it loose in the tree for a little romp, what would happen? He says, well, first of all, you'd never get it back. You would probably just let it up there. It would refuse to come down. It would be a huge pain to obtain it back. He also went on to tell me that you would practically never see it again. Apes would just melt into the background, melt into the plant life. You would never see it. They would hear you coming a long time before you actually saw it and would just leave the area, which really says a lot for Sasquatches being real animals, because again, Sasquatches, like all apes, predominantly use hearing to keep track of one another. So a clumsy human walking through the woods, approaching where a Sasquatch would be picked up immediately by a Sasquatch, and they'd probably just leave the area or perhaps watch from a safe distance. And I think that's probably where most sightings actually come from.
So another thing that I noticed is you guys kept on saying that it looked like it bounced off a larger creature. Now, was that something that the filmographer also noticed, or was that something that you guys had brought to the table?
Actually,
it was Steve Coles who figured that out. Steve Coles, who's also known as the Squatch Detective, did a lot of work on this particular piece of footage because he lives back east. So what he did is he looked at this thing on a big screen TV and he saw this figure underneath. No one had ever noticed it before. You know, Doug Pridgen, the videographer, he never noticed it before. But it was actually Steve Coles who discovered this particular aspect of the film. And I think that particular aspect lends a lot of credibility to the film itself.
No thanks.
Oh.
So Cliff, how come this is really the first footage of a so-called Sasquatch that's more like monkey-like, like swinging through trees? Is there more footage of Sasquatches being more monkey, ape-like in trees, or is it mostly just them on the ground moving through trees and dense forest.
Now the thing is that we have this piece of footage that shows a large upright figure and a small thing bounding off of its shoulders and swinging around in the trees after that. We're kind of left at like, what the heck could that possibly be? We know that this particular piece of footage was taken at a music festival. And in fact, the previous year at this same music festival, a dog bit one of the attendees, you know, bit somebody just a concert goer. And so this year, Doug told us, no animals at all were allowed in that music festival. And to Doug's memory, two people were turned away, one for having a parrot and another person for having an iguana. No animals at all were allowed into this particular music festival. So the chances that somebody had a pet gibbon or something like that are so small that we can basically count them out. Nobody here had a pet ape that went unnoticed for the entire weekend at this particular festival. So what the heck is in that thing? But so is this a person with a pet gibbon at a music festival that somehow went unnoticed? Or could it actually be that we're looking at an adult Sasquatch with a juvenile Sasquatch bounding off the shoulders? I think in this particular case, it is more likely that we're actually looking at a juvenile Sasquatch bounding off the shoulders of its mother, perhaps, than a pet ape that went unnoticed for 3 days at a music festival where no animals were allowed, where it's illegal to own a primate as a pet.
All right, Cliff, help us with this word brachiation. You guys used that a couple times. What's that all about?
Brachiation or brachiation, depending on the pronunciability of it, is basically a primate function. We are brachiators because our shoulders are built for overhead hanging, basically. So when you go on the monkey bars when you were 6 or 7 years old at elementary school, that actually is brachiating or brachiating. It's basically hanging from branches overhead and manipulating them to move around in the trees, which is exactly what we see this creature in the New York baby footage doing.
I'm always interested in the hard evidence that you have in the show. Like in this particular show, you said you heard 5 vocalizations. Could you elaborate on the vocalizations? And Do all the vocalizations and all the hard evidence get into every show, or does some of that, you know, hit the cutting room floor?
In this particular episode, we did actually hear what I interpret as Sasquatch sounds on 2 occasions. The first night investigation, Bobo and I heard 2 very loud, clear knocks within half a mile of where the baby footage was actually taken. I think that's significant because once again, we see that Sasquatches go back to the same places that they have been seen before. Whether that sighting was in 1997, like the baby footage, or like 1887, you know, it doesn't really matter. Where the habitat is good for Sasquatches 1 year and they are seen, they are likely to go there again. That's super significant for Bigfooters like us. Second of all, the second night investigation was in Fonstock State Park, I believe it was. A really, really great location. We were up on this hill. There's a pond or something, I think, at this particular location. On the other side of that pond, no roads, no trails. That's where we heard these sound howls come back to us. There were 5 of them. Only 1 of them made the show, but there were 5 of them in real life. And it's actually kind of peculiar. Matt and I were headed down the hill. The producer said, hey, let's stop for a minute and listen. So we went off the side of the trail and we started listening. And within a minute, we hear, ooh! Like long extended howls. And to me, the only 2 things that could make that sound, because it clearly wasn't a coyote or an owl or a person or anything like that. And we're talking Bigfoot or perhaps a wolf. But when I got back to civilization, if you want to call it that, I started looking up wolves in New York. And basically, wolves in New York have been extinct since the 1600s when the settlers killed them all.
Well, there is one interesting fact, and that is that wolves are actually breeding with coyotes and they're creating a subspecies right on the Canadian border there. And a typical wolf can wander down, 1,000 miles in what, 3 weeks or something like that. So it's very possible this new subspecies could be in the region. But what I found, the most interesting was you're an expert in this field. You're an expert on vocalizations. You know wolf vocalizations, you know coyote, and a hybrid vocalization between a wolf and coyote, not that foreign to a wolf or a coyote. What about the vocalizations really grabbed you as being genuine Sasquatch?
Well, the thing about it is our location, more than anything else to me, says that it was probably most likely a Sasquatch. Just because wolves, to everybody's knowledge, should not be in that part of the state. Now, does that mean that there are none and one accidentally didn't slip down and we accidentally heard it that night? It happened to accidentally be in the same place we were doing this stuff? It's possible. It's absolutely possible. But you know what? That's part of Bigfooting in general, is to go out there and see what you can get and try to eliminate all the possibilities. Right now, I'm at the only possibilities is wolf and Sasquatch. Knowing how wolves and like the natural history of wolves are is in New York, I would say that it's unlikely to be a wolf. Now, of course, most people would say it's unlikely to be a Sasquatch at all. But remember, Sasquatches are perfectly normal creatures that actually do live in North America. People who say they saw one probably did, because it's like seeing a bear or something like that. We heard a very weird, unidentified noise in the Catskills of New York. That noise sounds a lot like other Bigfoot vocalizations. Was it a Bigfoot? I don't know. I didn't see it vocalized, but I think it's at least likely, or at least possible, that it could actually be a Bigfoot. That noise we heard is unidentified. Wolf or Bigfoot? Which one is least likely? I think wolf is less likely than Bigfoot in this case. I could be wrong, but what? So what?
I got it.
Okay, it's hard to get a word in edgewise with this guy, but I think the question everybody wants to know, Cliff, is based on everything you've seen and done, what would you tell people that they should do if they want to have their own encounter?
So Thom, if you want to have your own encounter with Sasquatches, what you should do is look right outside of town. Look for any big sort of green belt where there have been deer, bear, and mountain lion sightings. If you can find a location like that within a few, you know, dozen miles of your home, then you're on. That's the place you should look, and that's the place you should start looking often. You should go there as often as you possibly can at night, and you know, basically try tree knocking. Tree knocking is really inoffensive. It's a very, very passive way to see if anybody's home. You knock on somebody's door, you're gonna find out if somebody's home. You knock on a tree in the woods, you're gonna find out if a Sasquatch is in that woods.
Hey Cliff, in another one of those encounters, there's a grocery bag. Do we know if there's anything good in that grocery bag that a Sasquatch would like salmon, apples, squeaky toys, candy bars?
Actually, you know what the witness did say is that he drove by it and the one item that he could see sticking out of the bag was a Captain Crunch box. So add that to the list. We have salmon, we have apples, we have Zagnut candy bars, and apparently Captain Crunch.
That is funny.
Okay, so here's my problem, Cliff, is I live in a rural area where there's much more woods around me than what we're seeing there in New York. I mean, you guys had 60, 80, 100 acre patches of woods. I got 3-4 times that. There must be Sasquatches out there. Should I be worried?
Worried? I don't think so, man.
Yes! Wake the kids, phone the neighbors, run! Bigfoots are here! Should I be worried?
That's funny.
Good job. No, you know what? Bigfoots are everywhere. Bigfoots are a lot closer in than anybody thinks about. They are practically in our backyards. If you live on the edge of society, if you live in a super deep suburb bordering national forests like you do, then absolutely, yes, Bigfoots are on your property. But should you be worried? I guess it depends if you're a worrier.
Well, then how come they're not on your show if they're everywhere?
if they were on our show, we'd have to call it Bigfoot Found instead of Finding Bigfoot. And then it would be the last season.
Of course, that would be the end right there. I understand. I know. Fold the tent, go home. Oh, man.
Hate it when that happens. Episode at Thom's house with apple pie and apple pies.
They might come up behind and like flick your ear.
Okay, well, I'm gonna go home to my woods. Yeah, thanks for seeing you guys.
Nice seeing you.
Happy New Year to all of you. And
you too.
All right. See you, Jack.
Happy New Year.
See you too.
Thanks a lot.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
It's always
Kurt,
fun.
See you, man.
See ya.
See ya.
Take care. Take care.
Bang that pot with a spoon and right. Happy New Year.
Can you bang that pot? Yay. Happy New Year. Woo! Happy New Year. Woo! 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 Happy New Year.
I guess that's a wrap!
If anything happens, happens, I'll let you know, but don't bring Matt, whatever you do.
That's going in.
That's definitely a squatch.